Usually, before I go shaking my tits for the press, I like to go see how the professionals do it. Some might say the chief of police has no business in an institution like this, but in fact it's the quietest and safest place in town. You won't run into any reporters, nobody gets into any fights, nobody drinks too much, nobody even raises their voice. The place is owned by an elderly gentleman who knows how to keep things under control. That's why I never invite my friends here. I wanted to make an exception for my 60th birthday, but most of my colleagues are young enough to be my sons, and they'd rather just hire prostitutes. Why stare at some boobs when you can take the whole package for yourself? But there's none of that in our club. Even looking too long is considered indecent. You can get an occasional glimpse, like by accident. The rest of the time you just pretend that you're immersed in conversation, or just come by for a drink. Doesn't mean these gentlemen wouldn't want their bald heads smothered in tits. It's just that nobody says it out loud. My younger colleagues might call it hypocrisy, but I call it the good old-fashioned manners. Good manners and leave the rest unsaid. She agrees to unbutton her blouse, and we agree not to pay too much attention. The girls are on a quiet prowl, too. They're looking for a way out of their cramped rooms. Maybe make friends with some wealthy patron with a pacemaker and dentures. Everybody wants something. But we have to control ourselves, or we'll all turn into libertines and prostitutes. Hell, if there weren't any rules, I'd be belching and farting, jumping up on the table, arms held high, yelling, "Shake it, baby!" No idea how I got so barbaric.
Hello everyone, my name is Inferno Canuck, and this is The Police, a fun, story-driven strategy game.
When I was a kid, my father sometimes told me at bedtime that if I closed my eyes and didn't open them for a long time, all the demons would blow away. Yesterday I turned 60, but I still take his advice. Not because I'm sentimental or want to keep the memory of my father alive. I just can't think of a better solution. To get away from all the demons that haunt Freeburg, I'd need to wear a blindfold 24/7. Plus, it's a good idea to act blind when talking to reporters. At least that's what my colleagues say. They're afraid of press conferences. But for me, it's more like a confessional. No matter what lies you tell, you're privately thinking the honest answers. It helps me remember who I am. The fact that I'll be reading all about it in the papers tomorrow is a small price to pay. Call it penance for the preacher. This is the first time I'm afraid of those answers my mind has given me. Not because I'm mad I'm losing my job. Though it's true, I'm mad as hell. Not because I subconsciously blame everyone else. Though I damn sure do blame them. And don't even ask me what my next move is. I can't imagine. But even that doesn't scare me. The worst thing is, I know I'm gonna have to do something. And I'll be damned if I know how far I'll go. I may have a lot of vices, but predictability isn't one of them. I learned a long time ago how to drive away the swarming demons. But what do you do when they're trying to rip your soul from your skin? Shutting my eyes tight as I can. The best solution remains the same. Play blind. I just hope the reporters think I was blinded by the camera flash.
Good morning. Yesterday, the mayor's office officially announced your resignation. Did this come as a surprise, or did you know about it in advance? Mayor Rogers told me that he wants a fresh face running Preburg PD. So no, it didn't come as a surprise. Do you already know the name of your successor? Of course not, and I don't think the mayor's office knows who it is either. After the recent corruption scandal, your deputy, Francis Kendrick, said he was looking forward to resigning. If the mayor offered him your position, would that change his mind? Sounds possible, if he thinks the new office would help him serve the city a little longer. Although Kendrick was acquitted, many still believe that the police are cooperating with the mafia. Do you have anything to say about this? Excuse me, but that's a pile of horseshit. The mafia and the police working together. Maybe they're in cahoots with the aliens. The mafia are a bunch of low-life criminals. How about someone ask a real question? Do you think your personal relationship with the mayor could be the reason behind your retirement? It's often difficult to say what guides policy decisions. Thank you.
How's the back today, Mr. Boyd?
Same as usual.
How did the press conference go?
You can read about it in the newspapers tomorrow. Don't let anyone in.
Even Mr. Kendrick?
Especially Mr. Kendrick. As soon as I heard the door creak, I knew what face I'd see. When I tell Emma not to let anyone in, there's only one man it could be. Rude, arrogant, no warning. That's Mayor Rogers in a nutshell. White summer shoes, white socks, white shorts, white polo shirt, and the white smile of a hungry shark. Mayor Rogers enters every room like he owns the place. Even the floorboards under his feet sound like they're creaking an apology. He never shied away from the odd corruption scheme. It's like the devil walks behind him. In the movies, the villains controlling the city play golf with the judges. Rogers plays tennis with them instead. That's about the only difference.
Jack, I was hoping to catch you after the press conference. You ran away so quick.
There's no smoking at City Hall. No reason for me to hang around.
Well, this morning I signed a ban on smoking in all public buildings. Soon you won't be able to smoke here either.
Soon enough I won't be here at all.
That's what I wanted to talk to you about. The people of this city like you, Jack. The police chief of all people. Don't betray that, Jack. Don't get wrapped up in any schemes. Sit nice and quiet for the next 180 days and you'll be remembered as a hero. That's the only thing that you still have left. be the hero.
Then how am I supposed to scrape together a retirement fund?
You had a million chances to secure a luxury pension, one that even I would have envied, although I've never set aside any money for myself. I'm not planning to retire anytime soon. ...180 days of quiet, Jack. That's all I need. I don't have any problems with you, and you won't have any problems with me. I have a new assistant, Troy Starr. If you have something to tell me, call him. But try not to bother him. He's a busy man.
I'll do my best.
And quit smoking up the office. One of my friends will be using it soon.
Oh, I'm sorry, babe. Only the mayor has this number. Mr. Mayor?
Yeah, is this Troy Starr?
Yes.
Go fuck yourself, Troy Starr. Cops don't use the police station cafeteria anymore. There's some kind of stigma against sitting shoulder to shoulder with your partners. Everybody just takes snacks from the machines or grabs a meal and hammers it down in the corner like a vulture on a corpse. The main thing? Don't look into anyone's eyes. Could be construed as an invitation to sit together. The only people eating here are ghosts. My deputy, Francis Kendrick, he recently became one of those ghosts. The subject of one of the most devastating corruption scandals in the history of Freeburg. No evidence to support the accusations, but everyone knows Kendrick's days are numbered. I need that file I asked for. Needs to be ready tonight. Francis didn't say anything, but I understood. Ghosts aren't supposed to talk. Besides, I got a feeling he was already finished.
So, for the sake of refreshing my own mind, and for those who might not be aware of this game, we're going to go through the tutorial. Freeburg PD organizes upcoming work assignments into shifts for today and tomorrow. Every shift, officer responds to crimes in progress, and detectives continue their investigations. You can freely move employees between shifts. All officers and detectives possess several important characteristics. Professionalism shows the overall efficiency level of your policeman. A figure around 150 is considered average. Any policeman who falls short of this mark is not entirely reliable, while those whose professionalism is considerably higher than average are a safe bet, even in a pinch. And individuals' level of professionalism may rise and fall over the course of their career. Energy shows how tired your policemen are. The less energy your people have, the less reliable their work, and a policeman who is exhausted might fall asleep at the wheel or make a critical error on the job. Your employees lose 1 point of energy after each work day and restore 1 point after each day of rest. Hidden characteristics. Your employees don't tell you everything. Some additional characteristics are hidden from view. For instance, some cops are lazy and will come up with any reason they can think of to take the day off, while others like to drink too much. You can only guess about these things, but you should be able to draw your own conclusions based on the behavior of your employees. One of the best things about this game is that you can approach it very differently, and I'm going to be approaching this with a certain personality in mind of the police chief. In addition, what I like to do is, not necessarily for detectives, but for police officers, I like to have the partnership system. So typically, I will partner up people. So in this case, I would take Koshi and Asano as a partner group, Yancy and Tsubaki, and then Purdy and Austin. Pretty much a veteran individual with one who is a little below average to kind of help them out and balance things out. And of course, Price is going to be a floater. As you can see, Price is extremely worthless. So we will only be using them sparingly. Calls. Responding to calls is the bread and butter of police work. You'll need to send your officers to the crime scene before the timer expires. A mark on the map shows where the call came from. The farther away the destination is from the police station, the longer it will take your officers to travel back and forth, so the longer your people will be tied up and unavailable for upcoming work.
110 in progress.
We have a hit and run at the Everyday Mall. Slots. The easiest way to determine how difficult a task might be is to check how many units you are allowed to send on the call. The more units you can send, the more serious the alleged threat. Alleged. Particularly risky missions give you the option of sending SWAT, but they must be accompanied by at least one officer. Descriptions. The number of slots is not the only thing to consider. Any available information, from the location of the crime scene to the presence of weapons and so on, all of this can tell you how seriously each case should be taken. A mission might look simple at first glance until it turns into a brutal meat grinder, or a serious call can come in which turns out to be a false alarm. So we have a hit and run at the Everyday Mall. A married couple exited a convenience store and saw a van in the parking lot, back over a homeless man, who'd been digging through a trash can. The driver jumped out to help, but once he saw that he'd hit a bum, he got back into the van and quickly drove away. Well, this is, a hit and run, and a serious thing, so we're going to break out Koshi and Tsubaki. Sorry, Koshi and Asano. We have a fight at the Last Picture Show Theater. A theater manager reports that during a show of Citizen Kane, a drunk man attempted to force his way into the theater, carrying a snowboard decorated with the word Rosebud. When he was denied entry, he violently attacked the cashier and is currently fighting with the theater's security guard. Okay, this is a fight, so we're going to need someone who's quite professional with this, so we're going to take Yancy and Tsubaki. When everything goes well, the police capture the criminals and nobody dies, but the truth is sometimes the criminals manage to escape. Just try to avoid any dead cops or civilians. Dead cops will hurt your roster, and dead civilians bother the mayor even more than living ones. So, for the Everyday Mall, the offender was caught, officers unharmed, and we gained some professionalism. With the fight, the offender was caught. No one was harmed whatsoever. More professionalism.
progress.
We have a new call here. We have two new calls. We're going to do this one first. A fight at Johnson, Jurgen, and Katz Law Firm. A brother and sister clashed with each other over their deceased father's will. According to one of the lawyers, we don't dare separate them, and their security guard is off duty for tonight. This is a family squabble. Doesn't seem like there's any weapons whatsoever. We're going to give Purdy and Austin this call. We're going to wait just a little while longer. Alright, an armed robbery. Three teenagers armed with a shotgun robbed a videotape store and made off with their whole collection of adult movies. The criminals fled in a car, but the store manager wrote down the car's license plate. The owner is one Janet Brown, who lives in the suburbs. We're going to have, let's see here. This is 370, this is 360. So we're going to take Koshi and Asano. Okay, an assault in the ghetto. A passerby saw some teenagers attack an elderly musician, then run away with his guitar and his money. We'll send our next available police officers, Yancey and Tsubaki. And you know what? It is three. We might as well send Price in as well as backup. Alright, with the fight, the offender was caught. No officers were harmed.
We've got a situation here.
Direct orders. When your cops aren't sure how to proceed, they might contact you and ask you to handle the situation. Try to deal with whatever comes up, but don't waste all your time on this stuff. You have plenty of other problems on your plate. So, the vehicle in question is parked right outside the Brown residence. The sounds of moaning and loud laughter can be heard through the living room window. These are teenagers. We're going to give them a scare. We're going to turn on the siren and loudspeaker and shout that the house is surrounded. And that did it. The offenders were caught, officers unharmed, more professionalism. With our assault, the offender was caught, no one was harmed, and big success all around. And we're going to go ahead and end the day. If you think you'll need a couple of extra hands tomorrow, you can order any cop to come in and work overtime. But they're working flat out. They'll be much more exhausted. Somebody's bound to make a mistake. We're not going to order anyone to work tomorrow, but I do want to point out something. Both Price and DeBrito, instead of going down one tick for being exhausted or tired, they went down two. This probably has something to do with their age. And so that's something we're going to definitely have to keep an eye on, especially with Price. As soon as we get the option, we're going to be giving her some early retirement as well.
Used to be, when I asked Kendrick to stay late at the office, he liked to grumble and crack wise. Nowadays, he doesn't have the strength for it. Slumped shoulders, blank stare, wrinkled skin. The past few weeks, I don't hardly recognize my old friend. In his younger years, he reminded me of a gallant royal officer in an old Kipling story. Kendrick isn't just crumbling under the weight of the public pressure, but from the shame of it all. Internal Affairs raided the library he inherited from his grandfather, hoping they'd find buckets of cash stashed in the pages. Heard about the look on his face, the fearless policeman standing helpless in horror. I've known Francis for 30 years. The past 20 years he's played loose with the law. And I know that at a certain point every stolen dollar brings more misery than anything else. Probably sounds crazy, but I sympathize with the guy. What can I do? Your friends are your friends, and these are the waters we swim in.
Called all of the people on that list today. Now they know you're in business, so you could get a call from any of them. You don't need to worry about any of them. I've cleared them all.
And what kind of business are we talking here?
It's nothing too serious, just like you asked. Should be just a few small favors. Payments will vary depending on the situation and who you're dealing with. How much are you looking to earn?
$500,000.
$500,000? Why not a whole million?
Because everybody wants to take $1,000,000. Figured I'd try something different.
$500,000 in 180 days? Well, you could earn it all above board if you netted all the big fish and hit all your bonuses.
Never knew you for a fisherman.
Well, you never got into my business, and I'm not trying to get into yours. But be careful about bringing in any other cops. Sooner or later, they'll put the finger on you. And one more thing, Jack. I remember what you said, but I should probably add one more name to that list. Christopher Sand.
Sand. Christopher G. Sand. Everyone knows the name, but few could tell you who he is. The old man stays away from the spotlight. Always wears old-fashioned jeans and knitted sweaters. Gives to charity. Rarely attends social events. An avid hunter, I hear. Even dabbles in poetry. You'd never guess he's the head of the oldest and most powerful gang in the city. Goes back as far as his great-grandfather. And Sand is strict about following the old rules. He rarely involves himself in commonplace murders and robberies. Hardly needs to intimidate anyone to get his point across. The people who work for him each have their sphere. They provide protection where needed, even work with the authorities when they want to make a deal. Meanwhile, Sand pulls the strings without getting his hands dirty. People sometimes mistake his quiet approach. A couple years ago, an arms dealer decided to expand its business without asking permission, and his whole family paid the price. In 4 weeks, Sand killed 31 people. Old men, women, even a few teenagers. And Sand's people made sure every paper reported it. Frank, I don't want to hear you say that name again.
Jack, please, listen to me. I'm in with these guys.
We agreed, Frank. That's not the kind of business I'm into. I don't go there. Never have, never will.